I hope you're all well, healthy, and safe during this time. For those of you who don't know, my name is Keisha Ras, and I am currently in matric, my final days of, you know, just wrapping everything up. And I am so glad to be your host today. Let's have a little recap of what happened last week. So Pastor Beryl shared a wonderful message with us titled, How to Give Thanks to God with a Grateful Heart. And during his sermon, he asked a question, and he asked if we still have a reason to be thankful. And I hope that that was something that you thought about this week, whether it was something as small as being thankful for a breath, the sun rising, birds chirping, you know, just the little things, or even someone smiling at you in the store, or smizing, because we only see everything from your nose up, smiling with your eyes. So, you know, the little things that can really cheer you up, make your day, or make someone else's day. It's things like this that God makes us feel like we should be thankful for. And Pastor Beryl responded to the question. He was like, yes, absolutely yes, we do have something to be thankful for. Why? Because God is still God, and He will always be God. And today we have a special service, a really great message titled Salvation, an Act of God, a Gift to Share. And that title alone is really powerful. It gives us already so much insight on what to expect on the service ahead. And we have worship from Rian and Susan Swart. We have reading by Laurence. And we have a video / testimonial from the youth. And then our main sermon, which will be done by Reverend Iain Kemp, which is from Edenvale Trinity Church, and he has been appointed by the Presbyterian Church to really just help us throughout this time and be the interim moderator whilst Beryl is on leave. And I just really want you to go and thank him. You know, maybe go in the comments, say thank you, Reverend Iain, for being here. Please support him. And I know that you guys will enjoy this message very, very, very nicely. And I'd like to start off with a prayer. So just close your eyes, take a deep breath in and out, and let's get into the prayer. Lord, I want to thank you for every present soul who is here today. And those who aren't here, I pray that you bless them. I pray that you make our hearts still and clear our minds so that we can absorb every single part of your word, Lord. Lord, may your goodness and love be present amongst us today. Bless Reverend Iain Kemp for the message he will share today, and may it truly stick with us and fill our hearts with you, Jesus. I pray this in your holy and wonderful name. Amen.
Amen. As we spend this time now to prepare our hearts for worship and meeting the Lord in praise and singing, and to hear from him what he has in store for us from his word, let us just think about the next song that we're going to sing. And I'll read some of the words to you. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. And it's a really challenging time for all of us, and I just want to encourage you to truly let go of the fears that you might be facing, and hold on to what the Lord has promised for us, and the Lord has promised good for us. And so as we sing now, just let Jesus be in the forefront of your minds. Let us sing. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
'Twas grace, has promised good to me. Swear my hope secures. He will my shield and portion. As long as life endures,
the earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbid to shine. The heart will call me near me now. Will be forever mine.
My chains are studying gave me time to actually study, you know. So yeah. So now I'm just laying back, which is my second semester. So in the meanwhile, I'm just, you know, relaxing, you know, taking a break, taking a breather. And I just hope.
Four things I find myself doing during lockdown. Korean.
안녕하세요. 내 이름 인켄입니다.
YouTube! Doobalang, welcome back to my channel, welcome to my new video. I am your host, Kine Lissaturke, and you guys are watching... Kine!
Hey, YG. What I've been up to during lockdown is actually not much of the physical, but rather more on the spiritual side of things. I had to do a lot of spiritual learning from my side, and just learning how to rest in God in this whole, well, not really regarding the pandemic, but then I really went through a lot, and yeah, but just learning how to rest in God and trust Him in all that is happening in my life. And yeah, I got to reconnect with my friends, and I really, really had, like, I know it sounds weird, but I really enjoyed lockdown. Like, lockdown has been amazing on my side, and I really love the relationships that I've built. Like, everything is just, it has more substance, there's more stability in my life, and I really thank God for that. Because, and yes, I had to make decisions, I had to purposely want to change, but yeah, that's what happened, that's all that's been happening. Thank you.
Hey yo, for my lockdown, I literally laid on my bed and slept.
Friends, I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is with us, who is present with us, and who connects us by the fact that we are part of the body of Christ. And I greet you from here in Edenvale, from my home, to yours, where I'm sure you may be engaging with this time of worship. And it's wonderful for me to be able to share with you this morning. As Keisha has shared, I am the interim moderator at St. Paul's. And it's a bit odd that I'm interim moderator, but I haven't necessarily been able to be with you as a congregation in person. And so all of this is something that we're learning, something that we're going to have to grow through and deal with as we go along. But I hope that you'll be assured of my concern for you as well, and to be able to be present in ways that I'm able to, and to the needs that are there, and that I can assist with as we journey in the next couple of months together, and especially as I journey with the council and the different committees, and especially with the search committee. And as we will hear about the progression of what's going to happen next week. But let me not go too far, and let's explore Romans at this point as we look in and dig into the scripture.
Good morning, St. Paul's. I really do miss standing at the back of the church and being able to greet you as you all come into church. But I'm grateful that we have the technology we have today, that we are able to share this church virtually on a Sunday morning. Today's readings are taken from Romans 10, verses 5 to 15. Hear the word of God. Salvation is for all. Moses wrote this about being put right with God by obeying the law. Whoever obeys the commands of the law will live. But what the scripture says about being put right with God through faith is this. You are not to ask yourself who will go up into heaven, that is, to bring Christ down. Nor are you to ask, who will go down into the earth, below, that is to bring Christ up from death. What it says is this, God's message is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the message of faith that we preach. If you confess that Jesus is Lord and believe that God raised him from death, you will be saved. For it is by your faith, it is by our faith that we are put right with God. It is by our confession that we are saved. The scripture says, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. This includes everyone, because there is no difference between Jews and Gentiles. God is the same Lord of all and richly blesses all who call him. As the scripture says, everyone who calls out to the Lord for help will be saved. But how can they call to him for help if they have not believed? And how can they believe if they have not heard the message? And how can they hear the message if it is not proclaimed? And how can the message be proclaimed if the messengers are not sent out? As the scripture says, how wonderful is the coming of messengers who bring good news. This is the word of the Lord. Have a blessed day.
So this reading from Romans is part of the lectionary readings which were for this Sunday. And toward the beginning of the week, as I was reading the various passages, I decided to focus on this passage that Paul writes to the church in Rome. But as I started journeying with the passage more, I got a sense that I may have bitten off a little bit more than I could chew. The reason is that because to properly deal with the passage, one needs to have an idea of what came before and the thinking of Paul up to this point. To pluck just one or two passage, quoted pieces of scripture, of which there are some very familiar ones in this passage, it may not quite do the justice that is required. And so in keeping this in mind, I've attempted to kind of give a brief context and then to zone in on perhaps two things that really stood out for me and that impacted me and grabbed my attention for this passage and the message for this today. So Paul was, who was once Saul, was a zealous Jew. He was proud of his heritage as a child of Abraham, and he was an Israelite of Israelites, one who even went so far as to persecute people of the way when he was a Jew. And he gives an account of his heritage in his letter to the Philippians in chapter 3. And if anyone could have confidence in their righteousness based on external ceremonies and zeal, it was him. After giving an account of his heritage, he then writes, "But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith." The book of Acts gives the account of Paul's encounter with Christ and his subsequent change of heart as he begins to learn about Christ, as he encounters Christ, and then he attempts to share the good news of Christ with others on various missionary journeys. He wrote letters to various churches, including the church in Rome, a church which was situated in the greatest, possibly the greatest city and in the greatest empire in the world at the time. And because of that, he chose his words and thoughts very carefully. And the letter reads more like a theological treatise than a personal letter. And so what we have are quite lengthy arguments which interpret Old Testament scriptures and present a case for salvation through Christ, which he tries to present to the Jewish believers, and as well as he appeals to the Gentiles. And he wants to share the salvation and the freedom that he received and experienced, and which he sees being interpreted through the scriptures, and the scriptures which point to Christ as the means, as the end of all things. And so particularly in chapters 9 to 11, Paul deals with the Jewish attitude to religion. There was a sense of entitlement, an elitist attitude, that they are the chosen people, they are Israelites. And there was also an understanding amongst the Israelites and the Jewish people that the more they obeyed the law, the nearer to God they could get. William Barclay gives a background to the Jewish approach to righteousness. He says, "The whole Jewish approach was that by strict and steadfast obedience to the law, a person earned credit with God. Nothing shows better the Jewish attitude than the three classes into which they divided mankind. There were those who were good, whose balance was on the right side. There were those who were bad, whose balance was in the debit side. And there were those who were in between, who perhaps by doing one more good work could become good. It was all a matter of law and achievement." And to this, Paul answers, "Christ is the end of the law." And what he meant was, Christ is the end of legalism. The relationship between God and human is no longer the relationship between a creditor and a debtor, between an earner and an assessor, between a judge and a person standing at the bar of judgment. Because of Jesus Christ, humans are no longer faced with the task of satisfying God's justice. They need only to accept God's love. They no longer have to win God's favor. They need simply to take the grace and love and mercy which God offers freely. Although Paul's writing may appear at times to be condemnatory toward the Jewish people, in fact, there is nothing but wistful longing and heartful yearning that the Jews may be saved, to know the freedom and the joy of knowing Christ as Paul has experienced and encountered Christ. Paul knows how difficult, how impossible even, it was to keep the law with all of its demands. And he writes throughout the letter to the Romans about how futile it is to earn one's righteousness with God, since all have sinned and fall short of the requirement of which the law demands for righteousness. It is out of Paul's reflection on the passages that he quotes from the law of Moses, which we find in the passages this morning, that we have the familiar words that he pens. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with mouth one confesses and is saved. This is to emphasize that salvation and thus righteousness is not something that we do, but something that God has done. In coming down into this world to a misdirected and a hurting people, and it reminds us that God is near, so near that it is within the grasp of every person who believes and every person who confesses their need for Christ as Lord, as the end of all things in their life. I want to remind us that it is not a recipe for salvation, as if we utter certain magic words and profess our belief and that is the end of it. Paul is not emphasizing a different way that we make salvation possible, as if we own it. These words are to emphasize the character of God, that it is God's doing and not our own effort. And so we need to be careful, just as Paul has been warning the Jews, not to make a judgment or rule about how a person is saved. We need to be careful that we do not claim superiority or become entitled about this salvation. It is always an invitation to us, once again, to be directed to God, to confess and believe and invite others to experience the same nearness of God, which leads to this confession and belief. Not only is Paul pleading with the Jews to come to Christ and see salvation in Christ, he's also trying to show his fellow Jews, even those who have believed and confessed Christ as Lord, the wide expanse of God's love and mercy, that it extends beyond just the nation of Israel. And since salvation is not an act of the person but an act of God, then salvation is for all people, Gentiles and Jews. And this is good news to me, because I fall into the category of Gentile according to Paul's argument. And so I have to, in my mind, simply say, how wonderful, how marvelous is my Savior's love for me that I can know this salvation. And Paul goes on to ask a series of rhetorical questions. He asks, how then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? This last question really stood out for me, particularly the word sent. If we work backwards in Paul's questions, you see that someone is sent, preaches the good news, this is heard and leads to belief, which is expressed in calling upon the Lord for salvation. And ultimately, Jesus is the one who is sent, who then preaches the good news, and whom people hear and respond in calling upon the Lord when they hear and believe. But Paul here is also giving an argument that those who believe become those who are sent. In John's Gospel, after Jesus is resurrected, he appears to his disciples and says, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." We read in the Gospels of Matthew and Luke and in the book of Acts of the same idea of the disciples being commissioned to go and preach the good news to the nations, to be witnesses. And so this was a good reminder for me to remember that to be Christian is to be one who is sent. The reason I think that this stood out for me is because for the last 4 months we've been told to stay in your home, don't go out, minimize physical and social interaction. And I feel like this idea of having to stay at home has had an effect on my outlook as well in terms of my faith. That it has become one which has become more inward focused, being concerned on my needs. And here I am reminded once again that as I have received this wonderful and marvelous salvation, I am sent with Jesus to preach the good news. And this does not change because of the lockdown. But it does mean that it may require looking for different and possibly creative ways to practice this sentness or being sent. And as a disclaimer, I'm not implying that we disregard the recommendations of social and physical distancing. I'm simply imploring us not to forget that we are sent people having received salvation. That we are, to put it this way, saved to be sent. And so perhaps to summarize what we perhaps can learn from Paul's message to his fellow Jews in this passage. It is that salvation is something which God does and to which we respond. And as such, it is available for all people, not the possession of an elite or entitled group. And finally, in the receiving of such a gift and becoming partakers in the righteousness of God, it means that we become sent people, sent to the misdirected and hurting people of this world, as Jesus came to this world and was sent by the Father. And we do not go alone, friends. We go with Jesus. And we are left with the words that Paul finishes off with in that chapter 15. How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. Amen.
My sorrow and dead in my sin. Thus were that old priesthood again. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my
I'm
Into a time of intercession, there are two things which I thought we could focus on and would be good for us to focus on. That is, or the first is in relation to today being National Women's Day, and the second is in relation to the devastating explosion which happened in Beirut. And so together let us pray. Loving and merciful Father, thank you that you are near us. Thank you that you have placed loving and nurturing people in our lives that share your love. For many, this love and nurture comes by way of a significant woman, a grandmother, mother, wife, sister, or daughter. And in this moment of silence, each of us gives you thanks for those specific women who play a significant part in our life. Thank you, God, that much has happened through the ages for the emancipation of women in our current day and age. Yet we recognize that there is still much that needs to be done. We hear cries of women in the workplace who do not receive equal pay to that of their male counterparts. We hear the cries of women who are abused at work, in public, and in their homes. We hear the cries of women who are forced into prostitution and trafficking. We hear the cries of women who are treated as inferior. And this needs to change. Would you strengthen the resolve of women who are fighting for equality? Would you heal the hurt inflicted upon abused women? Would you bring freedom and justice to the women who have been held captive? And change the hearts of those who perceive themselves to be superior, the abusers and the indifferent. Give us courage to stand up and speak out when we see injustices toward women taking place. And God, as we thank you for our relative safety in our homes, we are perturbed by the devastation which took place in Beirut after a massive explosion. There are many who have lost lives, many more who have been injured, and even more who have had to evacuate their homes. Oh Father, would you comfort the families who will be mourning, the injured who will be recovering, and the people who have been displaced. Strengthen the resolve of healthcare workers, people involved in the cleanup and rebuilding, social workers and counselors attending to the trauma, and leaders who will need to provide direction and account for the tragedy which occurred. Send people to be good bringers of good news and show by their action and presence your love for the people in Beirut. We pray and ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi everyone, it's me again. I hope you all enjoyed the service and the worship, and I thought it was a really good one. Let's start with offertory. I'd first like to thank each and every one of you who have been so faithful during this time of giving. It is such a blessing and we thank you. It doesn't go unnoticed. God sees you and we thank you for that. Our banking details will be on the screen, so if you feel in your heart that you would like to give, please do so. And if you've been collecting money at home that you would like to give to the church, you're more than welcome to drop it off at church. Just give the office a call, give Audrey a call so that she knows that you're coming and she knows why you're there. And if you would also like to drop off blankets or clothes at the church, that will also be so appreciated. I'd like to share a Bible verse that has to do with giving and something I'm sure we all know, but I'm going to read it out anyways. It's 2 Corinthians 9 verse 7, and it says, "Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly, not under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." I know we've all heard this, but I really just like to remind you that it should come from your heart. Not because you feel like you need to do it, but because you want to. And not only will God appreciate that, but we will also appreciate that too. And I pray that we use the money to the best of our use to really make the church a better place. And now I'd like to move on to the notices. It's a couple of notices, so let's just, you know, bear with me, stay buckled in. Next week we have Reverend John Kominos from Richards Bay Presbyterian Church, who is preaching The View to Call. Also, I'd like to encourage you all to please watch the upcoming interview with Brad Davies and Janine Brown, who have recorded a video with Reverend Kominos in order to allow us to just get to know him a little bit, know what he's about, who he is. This video will be available at 3 p.m. today, and it will be distributed via WhatsApp and email. So please look out for that, support it, and, you know, show it some love. And then, most importantly, because I love this, is birthdays. If you're with someone whose birthday it is today or upcoming, you know, I'm just going to give you a second. Say happy birthday, give them a high five, whatever you want, just show them some love. If it is your birthday, I really hope you have a wonderful day. I hope that God blesses you with many more to come, and that He truly makes you feel good. And then I'd just like to end off with a special request to really pray for Pastor Beryl, who has lost 2 family members. It's really sad, but I just pray that you are all able to keep him in your prayers and in your thoughts. He's lost his brother-in-law and his father's sister, who has passed away. Please give him some love, send him some words of encouragement, and just keep him in your prayers. And I'd like to just end off with some words of encouragement, something that you can think about and just go forth this week. I really want to encourage you all to go into this week with strength and determination. I truly want you to take in the words that Reverend Iain Kemp said, and I pray that God allows you to be filled with the words that has been spoken today, and that you always remember that Jesus is Lord, no matter what. He's the one person that will never leave you nor forsake you, and He is the one constant that remains in my life, and I hope that He is that for you too. You know, I really want you to be intentional this week with your actions in becoming closer with God and remaining close with Jesus. I pray that you all stay safe and that your minds are renewed in such a way where you're able to do good and do better. And now let us end with the benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Have a wonderful week, guys. Stay safe, and God bless.